سخنرانی سناتور توریسلی در کنفرانس پارلمان اروپا در بروکسل به درخواست هموطنان و نظر به اهمیت آن بازپخش می شود.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you very much. Our conversation is about liberty and Ashraf, but I think everyone in the room knows it's really about Iran. What is happening at Liberty is every much a part of the final showdown for a free Iran is what is happening in Syria. Or wherever else the Iranian regime employs its terrorism. This is a proxy fight on that regime. And it is one more reason why we, the international community, dare not lose. I was thinking something, listening to the discourse here this morning that is happening. You know, history is so hard to see when you see it up close. But a wonderful thing is happening here in the Western world. This European Parliament is becoming the conscience of the Western world. And what a wonderful thing it is to see. What a wonderful thing. And what a time for you to come into your own, when ever needed more than now, to be heard on behalf of the people of Camp Liberty and of a free Iran. The simple reality is, we, the international community, and each of our institutions needs to accept a simple truth. There is one thing you can say about the mullahs in Iran. As we tried to appease them, accommodate them, compromise with them, in failure after failure after failure, at some point you take a person at their word. They're not interested in appeasement. They're not interested in compromise. It is, speaks to the best of this Parliament and my Congress and the international community that we have tried and tried and tried. It is a good statement about us, but it will not work. Sometimes you have to look the truth in the face. In my country, I suspect, as I am sensing in this Parliament, a very broad coalition has formed in support of the MEK. Not simply because we think it is the best opposition group, because in reality, it is the only opposition group. The mullahs have destroyed any independent voice. There is no one left standing that has organization and leadership and resources and willing to make the sacrifice of life to bring freedom to the oppressed people of Iran. And so from Democrats, Republicans, left and right, as I am sensing in this Parliament, we stand firmly behind the MEK as the one organization that can end this nightmare for the Iranian people. Now, the road to a free Tehran today leads through liberty. But it's important to understand the attack on liberty. Much as those who sat in our chairs 15 years ago, 10 years ago, saw the attack on Sarajevo, not an attack on the people who live there, but on the credibility of your parliament and my Congress and the United Nations and the international community. We gave our word for the security of these people. The United Nations gave its commitment. We were to protect their lives. And we didn't. And we didn't. I understood the outrage of Sarajevo and Rwanda and a host of other places. I understood that. I don't understand the silence here. They didn't attack the people of liberty. They attacked the credibility of the United Nations and Europe and America. We were attacked. You, me, and we were left wanting. That's the issue that's before us today. But now the camp, people of Camp Liberty not in anger, but in a practical accommodation to the fact that we didn't keep our word, have made a simple request. They want to live. And to live, they want to return to the relative safety of Ashraf. Not an unreasonable request. Or they want simply the means to be defended in liberty. I'll tell you what they want. And anyone here tell me where it's unreasonable. They own bulletproof vests and helmets. They want no money. They want no gifts. They own them. They're at Ashraf. They'd like them brought to liberty. Unreasonable? The United States military had left T-walls for blast protection around the places where men and women now sleep in Camp Liberty for exactly this kind of attack. They exist. They were paid for by our taxpayers. They'd like them back into Camp Liberty to defend against another Liberty attack, another rocket attack. Unreasonable? Something wrong with that? They would like blast protection bunkers. They would like to know that there is a safety zone around the camp from which rockets cannot be launched. Who here can argue with one of those requests? Instead, we are told by my government and perhaps yours that security lies not in these means, but in leaving the country. I would accept that if we were talking about 3,200 people. But we've moved 7 in the last year. The casualty count of deaths is greater than those who have moved. But the request is that 70 or 100, 200. If you take every country now willing to accept people from liberty, everyone, assume there are no problems, get them all out tomorrow, it might be 500 people. 2,700 remain. No helmets, no T-walls, no blast protection, no safety, facing imminent attack. 2,700. If I were to say to this room is going to be attacked, 10 of you can leave. The remainder will stay and face death. Would you? And if you did, what kind of people are you? There's a wonderful quote I've remembered all my life. At the end of the Battle of France, as the Battle of Britain was beginning, the Germans sent a message to Churchill. Would he surrender? He was so contemptuous, he didn't answer. He simply said, "What kind of people do they think we are?" What kind of people would live in Camp Liberty if they would leave their children, their brothers, their sisters, their comrades, people they've lived with for 26 years, and a few would run for the door and leave the rest to fight for their lives? What kind of people would they be? That's not an answer for security. Tell me where we're wrong in what we've asked for. Tell me that having a few leave and leave the rest behind is right. And we'll do it. But you know it's not. And that's the line that separates us today. Now, how do we move this? Well, those diplomats who would prescribe accommodation with the Iranians, or leaving liberty, or remaining in danger, and waiting for the Iraqis to provide protection, they do not work for themselves. They are not a force unto themselves. They work for you, or for me. They are answerable in a democratic society to our constituencies. I know it's the hardest thing in politics is to see history up close. You can never tell where it's going or where it came from, even if after a few years it becomes obvious. Here's what's obvious. Even as we speak, the seeds of the end of the Iranian regime are being planted. You can see it in Syria. You can see it in Iraq. You can tell in international chambers. It is there. It is coming. Someday soon it'll appear as obvious as it can be. By being here today, you've chosen sides. You've done the greatest thing any parliamentarian can do, and why I believe this parliament is becoming the conscience of the Western world. Anybody can stand with the rich. Anybody can take the side of the powerful. Anybody can be intimidated by nuclear weapons. Anybody can be intimidated by oil. But those who will stand with the poor over the rich, the weak over the strong, they not only inherit history, but in moments like this can be proud of it the rest of their lives. Not only are you on the side of the rich, but from everything I believe, you're on the side of the winning. We have weeks, days, not months, not years, to save the lives of the people of Liberty. Remind your diplomats who they work for, and remind them the kind of parliament that you want to be, and everything that Europe should represent to the world. This is that moment. And thank you, Mr. Stevenson, very much for having me. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.